Yes, sir. We are going live, sir. We can start.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Thank you all for joining us in the live webinar for the second ever webinar in Games Tamil Nadu. So I know that you all will be excited as like me to know about the topic artificial intelligence in medicine. So you can ask all your questions in the comment section in the YouTube chat box. We will answer everything at the end of the session. To enlighten us in this topic, artificial intelligence in medicine, we have Professor Dr. K. Ganesan joining us here. We welcome you, sir. So to give a brief intro about him, he did his PhD in computational theoretical physics. Postdoctoral fellowship he did in applied mathematics for 3.5 years at UK. So he has been an entrepreneur, he has been a professor, and also for the past 17 years, he has been in the administration of VIT. So he has increased the placements, he has revamped the various courses and curriculums and got UGC approvals, and he has collaborated with various industrial people. He has contributed in various research projects, sponsored research projects. Also, he has filed various patents, and he has encouraged various people to file patents, and also they are currently in use in Indian Railways and various other industries. And also he has done various innovations, he has done various international collaborations, and also he is helping a lot of people to start their own startups, achieve their goals and dreams, and also to get good offer and placement. So we welcome you, sir. So
thank you, sir.
Over to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you all. First of all, I would like to thank the Global Association of India Medical Students, Tamil Nadu, for giving me an opportunity to talk on how artificial intelligence can be applied in medicine. In a nutshell, I may be talking on some of the ways, some of the applications which we have been working with some of the doctors nearby. And then also we have come out with few patents. And thanks to Corona, we were not able to capitalize in making it as a commercial product, but then we are on the way. So in the course of my presentation, I will also explain some of the basics and then some fundamentals if someone wants to work in the area of AI, in particular, like even if they have a problem in mind, they should know, what sort of problems can be solved in AI. So we need to have at least some basic knowledge of what is an AI. I will just to touch upon, and then I will try to minimize as much of mathematics and engineering as possible, so that we can think of some new directions and maybe new applications. So let me, before going into the presentation, I would like to say that when we want to apply artificial intelligence, we need a large amount of data with different varieties and so on. So first one has to understand what are the various kinds of data that are available, and then how I can leverage it for medical applications. For example, if you take presently, the doctors are broadly using three important kinds of data. So one is a plain text to data. Normally, if you are a doctor and then when a patient comes, you write a prescription in English preferably, or in sometimes even the local languages and so on. And otherwise, you will also prescribing them to go for some lab testing, especially, the clinical testing. When they undergo the clinical testing, again, they give you a report in the form of text to data. So most of your subsequent, treatment is highly dependent on these, clinical data, which are essentially in text format. And the second variety is signals. And of course, we also use, a lot of signals in the medical field. For example, your heartbeat, your ultrasound, ECG, EEG, and sometimes, people, talk and observe from the way, from their voice and speech, they are also finding out how much they are stressful and so on. So typically, the signals are, a kind of data which can also give a lot of, useful information about a patient. And of course, the third, which is emerging, is something called images. And different parts of the electromagnetic spectrum are now used while taking an image. For example, people are using X-ray, MRI, CT scan, and whatnot, PET scan, and so on. And also, people are using the live video camera feed and to find from the gestures of the patient they would also like to understand, you know, their stress level and so on. We will talk a little bit with more details and so on. So images and of course now videos are coming in a big way, because typically in any of these medical treatment or any medical devices, what happens is, as a doctor, you know, you all know that we may be using our common sense, namely, you know, by looking at the temperature of a particular part of a body of a human being, or when he is coughing, or when he is making a sound you hear, and then you are able to diagnose. Or sometime you look at, for example, you look at the eyes, look at the nails, and say based on the color of the, you know, the parts of a body, you are able to gauge or, you know, predict certain kind of, you know, diseases. So the human intelligence is primarily, you know, identifying or, you know, predicting a disease by maybe, you know, using the senses like touch, heat, sound, and maybe, you know, vision. So the same thing also, we can teach it for a computer by means of, you know, artificial intelligence technique. And then we can ask the computer to make a decision just like a human being is, you know, making it. So from an artificial intelligence perspective, so what we need to know is, suppose if you are working in text, for example, my applications are, you know, text-based application. So we need to understand something called natural language processing. I will talk briefly what do you mean by natural language processing and why do we need to do it for, you know, like an AI application. Then if you are working with the signals, maybe, you know, we need to do something called a signal processing. A signal processing is typically like a time series, you know, data. For example, if some patient is, you know, admitted in the ICU, if you want to continuously monitor, you know, his heartbeat over a period of time, if it goes into any abnormal levels, so immediately, you know, you see that something is, you know, going to happen. So you want to treat the patients. So typically, as a function of time, right, you know, the heartbeat signals are continuously varying. So that I can capture it. Maybe in our x-axis, I have time. And in the y-axis, maybe some amplitude of a particular signal. So in the case of heart monitoring system, you want to see that how frequently, you know, the heartbeat is happening, that you want to record and so on. So it is equivalent to something called a time series analysis. And then if you are using images, and we normally call these as a computer vision nowadays. So what you do is, from an image which is taken from an X-ray or MRI or CT scan or PET scan with respect to a particular portion of your body, you want to see that what kind of interesting features you need to be there. For example, when we take an X-ray as a doctor, you will be, you know, under the lights. You will look at, you know, the images, and then you look for certain, you know, features, maybe certain characteristics in it. So the same thing also we can give it for an artificial intelligence system to do it, you know, automatically without even a human intervention. Okay, so the next we will see is what are the challenges we have. For example, if I want to take processing of a text, what kind of, you know, challenges we have. Of course, the text is in different formats. For example, it may be a plain text. When I say plain text means the one you type in Notepad or, you know, MS Word and so on. So the advantages of all these plain text are that, you know, when you digitize it, and then when you write a different application, assuming that one device is generating the data and then it is storing the diagnosis in a plain text format, but then if you want to pass it on to the other device, it should be able to understand. So two different devices, when they want to communicate, you need to communicate in general by using a plain text. So the interoperability across medical devices is possible if you store your text to data in plain text format. The second is, you know, something called hypertext. So nowadays, you know, we are all, you know, using internet. Not only we want our application should be a standalone working with a particular device, but then you want to push the information into the cloud or into the internet, or from the internet, you want to pull some data and so on. So when you want to make your application to be web-enabled, what we need to do is we are bringing in something called a hypertext. So whenever there is a hypertext, you always, you know, there will be a link which may be looking at in the blue color by default. When you double click on it, it takes you to a different, you know, computer wherein you will get more information about the content that you are, you know, looking at. So normally now people are in the world of, you know, web application, they mix a plain text with the hypertext. That is second. And third thing is PDF text, and it captures all the elements of the printed document as an electronic format. It uses special softwares like, you know, Acrobat Reader and so on. So sometimes, you know, you want to use it for legal purposes or maybe for insurance purposes and so on. So you want to store in a special software so that it can be even printed, or sometime when it is printed, you want to have it, be read by your computer software. So that's the place where we use a portable document format, which is also a text format, but it is more tuned towards a printed document. Then comes, you know, proprietary text. Here, a file format of a company which contains the data stored according to a particular encoding scheme, such that the decoding and interpretation of the stored data is done only with a particular software or a hardware. So here, the company which is making the software, they want to store the data in a particular format so that the person who is using that software alone can, you know, read it. So when I have the vital data or my equipment is pretty expensive, always I want to use a proprietary text and so on. So it's not something very convenient for other application to read. And then there is something called, nowadays we use something called Unicode. So when I say Unicode, people want to, write the data in different languages. For example, when we speak even in Tamil, in between we use English words, or even Hindi, we may be using, you know, English words and so on. So it's very difficult nowadays somebody to speak only in one particular language. So the same is true. The doctor with whom we are working here, and we being at Vellore, you know, close to Andhra Pradesh, border of Andhra, he is getting, you know, a lot of people from, you know, Andhra. And moreover, he is near to VIT where lot of, you know, North Indian students are there. So typically I could see that when a patient is coming, he has to explain in his own native language, apart from, you know, English. The medicine name may be in English, but the way you will be using and so on. So if you really want to make him to understand or even to attract, you need to use, you know, multilingual language. So the same is true. Even when he writes in a prescription, I will show you a demo wherein he writes, he is asking, what is your mother tongue? Accordingly, you know, he is writing, you know, how medication he has to take up. So now we know that there are different kinds of, you know, text. Now let's see what challenges we have if you want to handle these text. For example, if you know, whenever you write any text, we want to follow certain grammar. It may be in any language, but we have a grammar. But of course, this grammar is not standard for each language. So what is the grammar followed in English? It may be different in Hindi or maybe in Tamil and so on. So when you use multiple languages, first you need to understand any text message means what is the grammar they are following it. And then comes spelling of the words. And of course, many a time, the spelling also varies from country to country. For example, if you take, there are minor differences between, you know, British English versus US English. So maybe in Britain, they may write a C-O-L-O-R, but in US, they may write a C-O-L-O-U-R or vice versa. So there are some, you know, spelling issues are also there. Then there are issues of pronunciation. So when people, you know, nowadays, you know, we start dictating, and then there are speech to text softwares are there, which are, you know, converting into a text format. Suppose if I'm going to show you a demo or a product where at the time of, you know, doctor, when he is explaining to the patient how he has to take a medicine, you know, he may be, you know, using his own pronunciation. That pronunciation should be known to the patient as well. So now the issues are, for example, speech to text. As I mentioned, if I use college, you know that typically, you know, a Keralite may pronounce as college. Maybe a Tamilian may be pronouncing it as college and so on. So it's the same spelling, but then people are, you know, pronouncing it in a different way. But in the medical field, you know, if you are a doctor, your pronunciation should not mislead to a patient. So we need to take care of these issues. Of course, there are vernacular words, and sometimes it is very difficult to find these words in a dictionary. For example, we say that bothering. If you look at the word bothering, is typically used by Indians, or we use the words like, you know, jugaad and so on. So when you are, the way you are speaking, if you are started using these words, so even if it is given to your computer, as it is not in the dictionary, it may be finding it difficult to understand what it is. So then comes, you know, sentiment analysis. And here we are also going to use words according to the mood. So the same person, when he is happy, he may be using certain words, but when he is very angry, he may be using, you know, some other words. It may mean the same, but you know, the way when you talk to a patient, even the words that you use, right, it is going to make a lot of difference, especially, you know, if you want to you know, convince a patient, or if you want to attract a patient, the kind of words that we use also will make a difference. So when you say something at the end, you know, we need to say that, is these words are in a positive sense or maybe in a negative sense, which is going to make a lot of difference for a patient. Then comes vocabulary. And again, a set of words are used by a person, which again varies from one individual to another individual. So, you know, it's again, people say that a typical human being, even though there are about 2 lakh words are there in a dictionary, they always use maybe some 5,000, 6,000 words in our, you know, day-to-day life. So instead of, you know, creating a dictionary or a vocabulary for all 2 lakh words, which is there in the, you know, in the typical, you know, encyclopedia or dictionary, if you are making a custom-made dictionary, which is meant for the kind of words that you are going to use, what is going to happen is the storage that you use or the response of our system and even the accuracy of your artificial intelligence model that we are going to build will be better than using, you know, a general, you know, a dictionary. And then comes image text. When we talk of image text, one can read the image text using optical character recognition and so on. For example, if I take a medicine or a pill or a tablet, they have printed some text and they may be in different color, different fonts and different, you know, size and so on. So if I take a snapshot of that image and then I ask my system to tell what is written on it. So many a time, you know, you see that people may be using a lens and then they may be reading what is there and so on. So instead, nowadays, you know, we have a camera in our mobile phone. So can I take a snapshot of it and then ask, you know, what is the, let us say, the composition of the medicine, or maybe what is the date of expiry, or, you know, which company has manufactured. So all those information I can ask the, you know, artificial intelligence system to read. So in that case, you know, the we use a technique which is called optical character recognition. So the text can be present inside an image. And again, AI can be used here and to read the text. Then when we say optical character recognition or optical character reader, it's an electrical or electronic or mechanical conversion of images of typed, handwritten or printed text into a machine encoded text, whether from a scanned document or a photo of a document or a scene photo, or from a subtitle text superimposed on an image. So typically what I'm talking is some printed document is there. It can be a photo or it can be a you know, snapshot taken in your mobile phone. And so whatever the script it is written by hand or printed, it is basically when you take it becomes an image, like a graph, you know, a graphics. So from there, I cannot read it. So we need to have an intelligent system which is going to convert that image file into a text file. That's what your optical character recognition or OCR is doing it. And then comes, you know, each language has got a different font. So the problem here is, now we say I have mentioned something Algerian called ML and then something called Kunstler script, etc. and so on. So all of them are written in English, some alphabet, and it refers to some name, right? But then when you print it, it looks with a different look and feel. So when somebody writes, we may see that he may also write in different styles and fashion. So how do we ensure that, you know, our artificial intelligence is able to understand? I'm not talking about handwritten, you know, fonts. Even the printed fonts itself have got different variants of there. So no matter, you know, whichever variant you have printed, your, you know, the tablet or on the medicine, I should be in a position to read it. So if the letters in the document are cursive, then machine learning algorithms are used to recognize. So later on, I will show you, you know, that if something rightly, these curly signatures or prints are there, so we may not be able to use the conventional image processing technique, but rather now people use something called a machine learning algorithm, which is even able to recognize, you know, what that you have used or written. For complex handwriting recognition, we are using, you know, deep learning based OCR. And for example, you take, this is with one of the doctors, nearby with whom we are working. So he is a pediatrician, right? And then he has got such a complex, you know, format. You see here, he has written in English, in Tamil, and then he scribbles something. Of course, a trained pharmacist, he may be able to read what he has written it. But then, now I want to see that, can I use an artificial intelligence engine to tell what he has written? So this is something like he has written, and then using what we call as deep learning technique, my system is able to tell. The name of the medicine is Rhinoclear, and then it is a drop type. And because the issue here we are going to see is it is with a pediatrician, because a pediatrician is using different varieties of, you know, medicine. Maybe at the early stage, he may be using drop. Then, you know, he may suggest, you know, like syrup. Then he may say suspension. Then he may say tablet. And then some rarely he may be even using different doses of, you know, the tablet, depending on the age of a kid or a child. And then later he may be also using a capsule. So the difficult thing is the same brand or, you know, the medicine may be coming in different formats. It is not only the name, but then, you know, you need to see that, you know, in which format he has written it. So we just want to build an AI system, which is basically reading your text, which is, you know, as complicated as this, and then extract all sorts of information. So for doing this, what we need to use is something called natural language processing. So what is natural language processing? The goal of natural language processing is to enable the computer to understand language as we do. Just like, you know, a human being is able to understand any language like English, Tamil, Hindi, we also want a computer to understand a given language. So it's used in many virtual assistants, speech recognition system, sentiment analysis, automatic sex recognition, machine translation, and so on. So in the last 20 years, you know, huge amount of research has gone into, and there are many applications which have come out. For example, some of the classic applications of NLP are voice assistants like Alexa and Siri, and also things like machine translation and text filtering. So when you use, you know, Cortana, or when you use, you know, Google Voice, or, you know, like Amazon Alexa, or, you know, like Apple Siri, all they are basically using, when you say something, it is immediately understanding. And then your voice is converted into a text thanks to the natural language processing techniques. And the other area is speech recognition, the translation of spoken language into, you know, text. So this is again, you know, very, very, you know, important. Sometime, you know, my voice may even change due to cold, or maybe, you know, like if I am sneezing, right? My voice will look like, you know, slightly different. But then your system should not, you know, recognize it as a different text. It should, you know, translate it into the right text. So when we talk here in the natural language processing, there are two important tasks. One is called syntactic analysis, and the other is called semantic analysis. And of course, these are the two main techniques which are used in natural language processing. When I say the syntax, it refers to the grammatical structure of the text. When I say something, you know, like my name is Ganeshan, I will see whether it is syntactically, you know, correct or not. As per the grammar of the given language, I will see whether it is right or not. So when you written it properly, if the other fellow also knows the not only the language, and if he also knows the grammar, then he will easily understand. And then the second term is called semantic, which refers to the meaning that it is, you know, conveying it. So you may say something, it may be, you know, all the words which are there in the English dictionary, but then if you stitch them together, it should convey some meaning. Otherwise, you know, what is going to happen is he may not be able to understand. So a sentence that is syntactically correct does not have to be semantically correct. For example, I say a sentence, cows flow supremely. If you look at these words, cows, flow, and supremely, all of them may be in the dictionary. So I take them and then I stitch them together. And when you say something, you know, like people will say, is this fellow is a mad fellow? How can a cow will flow? And that too, he say it is flow, you know, flowing with the supremely, and so on. So if you look at all these words are grammatically correct, because we have a subject, we have a verb, we have an adverb. So, but it is not making, you know, any sense. So we need to see that when any, you know, like a text which is given to your computer, it has to parse it and see whether it is first conveying a meaningful grammatically. First you can see it is grammatically correct, and then you see whether it is meaningful or not. And you take the other example. For example, if you say something, you know, grammatically correct, again, colorless green idea, sleep furiously. Here, grammatically correct, but it is having no meaning. Because ideas cannot be green. When you talk some idea, if you say green idea, again, when you say green, it is a color. How can you say colorless? And then you say sleep. Okay, it's a verb, but you say furiously. When you say you are sleeping, you can say I am sleeping deeply or, you know, happily or restlessly and so on. But you can't say that. When you are furious, you cannot, you know, sleep. So all these words are grammatically, you can stitch them together. But then syntactically, you know, we need to see that whether it is making sense or not. Okay. Now, so for all this, the fundamental thing we need to understand is any text, if you want to apply natural language processing or AI, is you need to do something called parsing. So parsing means an analysis of a sentence by a computer into its constituents, which results in a parse tree, which will show their syntactic relation to each other in a visual form, which can be used for further processing. So the most fundamental natural language processing starts with parsing. So when I say parsing means, if you are giving a sentence, I will, you know, remove them into a set of words. And then I will ask what these words to refer to according to your grammar. And then, you know, like which is subject, which is object, which is verb, which is noun and so on. And then I will find out what kind of, you know, relationship they have. So once if I am able to parse and then identify a relationship, then I can say that whether the sentence that you have spoken is, you know, semantically correct or not. So for example, you take the sentence, the thief or burglar robbed the apartment. Here, along with the description of the three different information types. So I can identify the noun, which is namely thief or burglar, and verb means robbing, and a determiner is the apartment. So a word or a group of words that specifies, identifies, or quantifies the noun or noun phrase which follows it is conveyed by it. So typically my, you know, what you call parsing has to create this analysis. Here, the determiner can be an article or cardinal number or ordinal number, or it can be anything. For example, you see here, the sentence I have given is the thief robbed the apartment. So what a computer does is, when we apply the natural language processing, it is seeing that the is a determiner. And then it can be, it is a thief or robber is a noun. Again, if it is robbed is a verb. Again, you know, the apartment is a noun. So what it does is, you know, it is attaching a noun with a determiner, and then it is attaching with a verb, which in turn is connected with, you know, your NP. Here I call this as NP and VP. NP means noun phrase and verb phrase, because the thief is one phrase which is related to a noun. So I call it as noun phrase. And then robbed the apartment, which is a verb phrase, because it's a phrase related to a verb. So now I take this noun and verb, and then I create a sentence. So if you create a typical sentence, I'm decomposing it into a noun and verb phrase. And then in the noun phrase, I look for the noun and determiner. And in the verb phrase, again, I look for a verb and the, again, is there is a verb phrase or a noun phrase. If it is noun phrase, once again, I decompose it. So typically what I get is here, how they are, you know, related. So once we are able to do this, then it is easy for your, you know, computer algorithm to understand whether you are talking something meaningful or not. Then the second issue you may be very frequently using is called stemming. It's a process of reducing words to their word stem. Means a stem is part of a word which remains even after removal of all its suffixes. It's as simple as assuming that if you are learning a new language for the first time, and then, you know, when you start using it, you may be, you know, using lot of, you know, grammatical mistakes. For example, we have been taught when you use, you know, third person singular simple present tense, you need to add a yes along with the verbs. He walks on the lawn. So here he is the third person and singular. And then walk is the verb. But then if it is a present simple present tense, we have been told that we need to add yes. Suppose if it is past tense, we need to add ed. And then if it is present continuous, we may be adding, you know, ing and so on. So basically the stem word is touch. But on top of it, we add the cosmetics like ed or ing or s, depending upon the grammar that you are talking. Now imagine that if some Chinese or some other language person is coming and then he is speaking to you, you may know that he is not using proper grammar. But then if you use a relevant word, right, you will able to understand what he is, you know, for conveying. So typically in a computer also, we treat it like some foreigner is speaking. And then when you use multiple formers of the same word, we are only considering the base word or what we call stem word. And this process of removing these things like, you know, ed, ing, s, etc. are called stemming process. So why do we need to do this? The stem is needed because we are going to encounter different variations of words that have the same stem and the same meaning in our conversation. So in our conversation, even if somebody says he walk on the lawn, we are not going to find of course we can understand that he is not speaking proper English, but then you will understand that what he is trying to convey. So for conveying, right, you know, or what we call understanding, you know, whether he is talking something which is relevant, even we can remove these words. So for example, you say, I was taking a ride in the car. I was riding in the car. Both are conveying the same message. So these two sentences mean the same thing and the use of the word is, you know, identical. So this is what we are doing it later, you know, when we call something called, you know, chatbot, right? We also use the same technique. The same message may be conveyed by different people using the vocabulary and grammar of a given language. So all we need to do is, in the case of an artificial intelligence, look to my computer, all these refers to the same context. So for that, the stemming is very, very, you know, essential. So once if you know these two are stemmed, you will get the same sentence. Then comes a text segmentation. Here, it is also a process of transforming this text into meaningful units, which can be word, sentence, or a different topic, and so on. So once if a sentence is given, we will break them, or if a topic is given, we will split them into paragraph, and each paragraph into sentence, sentence into word. And then we will see whether these words are there or not. For example, it works relatively well in English to separate the words by spaces, except for a few words like icebox, where I may be using a dash. So in most of the cases, it is, you know, very easy, because we need to, this is what I call this as parsing, right? You know, segmenting your text into the smallest units and then see what is the meaning of it. And then you start stemming. And then also you ask what, you know, like parts of speech it belongs to. So if you want to do all this, first step is segmenting your text. Then we use something called named entity recognition, which concentrates on determining which items in a text or named entities can be located and classified into a predefined category. So typically what a computer or your natural language processing algorithm does is they categorize, or what we do is classify. For example, the names of a person, it identifies where is the name of a person or name of a company, or if it is some value, what is the value of that money, or if there are some percentage, what is that, and so on. For example, if you take, if I say Martin bought 300 shares of SAP in 2016, here the noun or what we call person is Martin, and then bought 300 shares is of SAP is a company or organization, or in 2016 is the time. So it identifies, you know, the important things. If you know that one person has bought some shares in which year, and so on. So once if you have the basic information, if you are extracted, then finding the relationship between them is little easier. And how do I find the relation?
Sir, yes? Sorry for the interruption. Your voice is like quite less audible.
Okay, sorry. Is it audible now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Fine. Thank you. So now we need to say the last part is, how do I find the relationship? It takes the named entities and identifies semantic relationship between them. So once if you are given a sentence, we need to see that what kind of, you know, relationship they have. For example, finding out who is married to whom, that a person works for a specific company, and so on. So here you look at Fred and Mary got married. Now Fred is a noun, Mary is also a noun, got and married are verb, and is a conjunction. So once if you are able to identify, you know, break the sentence into words and then link it to the vocabulary or maybe what we call as the grammar of a given language, then, you know, it is easy to connect them. problem in transformed is now transformed into a classification problem where we train a machine learning model for every relationship type. For example, I can have a database where I can say that if the name is Fred, means it is the name of a person, Mary, name of a person. And then all the verbs I can store it in a database, like, you know, get, got, and then marry, married, all these are, you know, verb. So the whole problem is now splitting the given sentence into words, and then you classify the words into what kind of, you know, grammar they belong. After that, you know that if there is a subject, there should be an also a verb. And then also maybe things like, you know, conjunction is there, more than one verb is there. All these, you know, we can add into our algorithm. Then people also, as I mentioned, we use sentiment analysis. Here we determine the attitude of a speaker or a person or a writer with respect to a document or interaction or an event. So many a time, you know, the doctor will also, you know, when he is talking to a patient, so he is more, you know, looking at his sentiment. Accordingly, you know, he treats him, right? Whether he is, you know, responding him or whether he is, you know, recommending something, he always uses, you know, sentiment analysis. So some of the sentimental categories are positive, negative, neutral, and so on. So a doctor's advice to a patient about medication in general follows this sentimental analysis. Predict, for example, a customer's opinion and attitude about a product based on a review he wrote about it, and so on. So these are some general examples. Now the next level, when you go for AI, where, you know, in the medicine field people are using, they are trying to use something called, you know, chatbots or conversational, you know, AI. We have also, maybe later I will show you in the final demo if possible, we are also using this conversational AI when a doctor is, you know, discussing with a patient. So what is this? A typical chatbot is an application of an artificial intelligence that we can interact with either by our voice or text. So typically it is like what you use, you know, in Google Home or Amazon and so on. But then we want to do it. We don't want to take your data to the Amazon or maybe, you know, your Google Cloud and so on. So can I create a custom made chatbot between the doctor and the patients whom he is, you know, treating? And typically, you know, this is a device with an audio and maybe there will be a speaker system. So it can ask as if, you know, I'm sitting in front of a doctor, assuming that there is the doctor is not there. And so he is coming and then sitting in front, and then as if there is a doctor is sitting, he is, you know, asking the questions. So the AI or chatbot will respond to him. So it can be interaction can be through voice or it can be a text. Suppose if we are looking for a medicine on a pharmacy website, we can search and then, you know, purchase it. Suppose if you have a huge database, even when we met some of the automation, we went to the pharmacy. They said we have around 9,000 to 10,000 medicine typically in a small medical shop. So when I go and say some particular medicine, so immediately, you know, that fellow has to understand or you need to write and so on. So imagine that I have a, you know, kiosk wherein I just go and tell what medicine I want. So instead of, you know, telling and then waiting in the queue and then the pharmacy wala calling, what do you want? And then he goes and types into his computer ultimately saying, sir, it is not available in the stock. Can you come afterwards? So instead, can I imagine there is a kiosk where I will just go and type or tell, I want this medicine. Do you have with you? So it can immediately say, yes, you have a medicine, or it can say that, no, no, I have an alternative medicine. I may say, I may want Calpol, but you may say, I may give you something like, you know, Metacin or something. Equivalently, it can do. So those kind of intelligence systems can also be, you know, built. In fact, we are also, you know, now working with the doctor where when he writes something, you know, before writing it, he wants to ask the chatbot whether this is available there in their pharmacy or not. So instead of writing something which is not there in the pharmacy, he will simply ask, is this medicine is there? So the chatbot will say, yes, it is there, sir, please you prescribe it. So he can even, you know, write on it. So what if that pharmacy makes a bot and sets it up on Facebook Messenger so that we can message it or tell it what we are looking for, and it will provide the, you know, option. So this is what we said. I can tell what I want, and then it can give me a recommendation. Based on that, I can choose what is available in stock in my shop or my pharmacy. So conversational or artificial intelligence refers to the technologies like chatbots or voice assistants, which users can talk to. So they use large volumes of data, machine learning and natural language processing to imitate the human interaction, recognizing speech and text inputs and translating their meaning across various languages. So in a nutshell, what this chatbot can do is it can be even in a multiple language. So the patient may say everything in Tamil or even in Hindi or Telugu, but then the database may be in English. It can convert and then understand, and then it can respond even in the voice of a doctor. Or I can even record the voice of a doctor and then I can play whenever it is needed. So maybe, you know, before I'm keep on using the word what is called machine learning. I will just introduce you. What do you mean by machine learning? Machine learning is the study of computer algorithms which will improve automatically, you know, through experience. So typically, what is this machine learning? Because you know that any learning, whether it is, you know, dancing, singing, or even, you know, if you want to have swimming, what happens is you need to take a lot of practice. And then even when you take a lot of practice, not only in one platform, for example, if I want to learn driving, if I drive only in highway where the roads are pakka, and then you can nicely overtake and so on, you are all right. But then suddenly, if you go into a place where the roads are very narrow with a lot of potholes and like, you know, people are crisscrossing and so on, so you'll be becoming, you know, very nervous. So you'll become a competent, you know, driver unless you are trained, not only with a large, you know, varieties of data, but then also with a huge amount of data. So in the typical machine learning, what we do is we are teaching the computer algorithm, you know, all our, you know, experiences. So people generally say this machine learning algorithm is a part of artificial intelligence. So here we build a model which is based on the sample data known as a training data. And we make predictions or decisions without being explicitly programmed to it and so on. So how this machine learning is different is, normally if you look at, you know, people use some sort of programming language like C, Java, Python and so on, wherein you, when you state your problem is translated into a set of, you know, programming instructions. So the data flows through and then, you know, it gets an output out of it. So it is highly dependent on what is the logic or what is the program that you have written, right? So that is the flow it is doing it. Whereas here, in the case of machine learning, what happens is it is more of training based. You know, when I say training based, I give a lot of samples, and also all these samples have got a variety in it. So machine learning algorithms are used in a wide variety of applications like email filtering, computer vision, where it is difficult or infeasible to develop conventional algorithms to perform the needed task. So where I'm going to use, we will see. For example, ML is used for disease identification. So once if we give a MRI or a CT scan or something like, you know, even if the radiologist is not there, no, I can say what kind of, you know, disease, can I predict it? Just like in the ECG, you know, when you take a report, the algorithm is saying where the defect is there, you know, in which low PQRS we have defect and so on. Something very similar, you know, we can do it. ML-based image analysis, they are 1,000 times faster than the humans. The advantage of here is that in many cases we have seen, or literature is saying, that compared to a human being, the machine learning algorithm can detect diseases very fast. And people are using AI-powered robotic surgery. It is reducing the pains, they say, up to 21%. So now people are using, you know, the robots for, you know, surgery, painless surgery, or they say less pain. And then people are also creating something called virtual nurses, which is, you know, taking 24/7 on patient care. And ML is used mainly in diagnosis and prognosis to drug development and epidemiology and so on. So you name any field now, it is coming up in a big way. And I may show you a simple example how, you know, the ML is working. But of course, we can even change this example for a medical application very easily. So one of the technique which is used is called Naibase. It's a simple machine learning algorithm, and it assumes that all the variables in the data set are not correlated to, you know, each other. So this is something like a drawback of this. But then people have also devised a lot of other technique. But here we assume that, you know, whatever we have a data, and it doesn't, one, when you do something, you know, it is not going to affect the other. For example, which is not true. If I study well, probably, you know, I may I may do very well in the examination. So that means doing well in the examination is related to studying well. But then what Naibase is saying is that kind of connections it is not considering, right? So whatever you do is, it is assuming that everything is fresh. It has got no connection for the prior data. So we are walking on the playground, and assuming that a simple case, you are walking on a playground and you are seeing a red object. The red object can be a bat, or it can be a cat, or it can be a ball. Assuming that these three possibilities are there. Of course, you know that there cannot be a red cat, but for argument's sake, we take different kind of objects are possible. Basically, when you see something on the road, you want to classify what it is. Let's create a machine and give the task of classifying it's an object in between cat, ball, and a cat. So I'm writing a small algorithm where I'm telling you, tell me whether it is a cat or ball or bat. For this, the machine has to identify the characteristics of the object and then map it with our classification objects, such that if an object is a circle, so essentially what you should do is you just take a photograph of that object, and then you analyze it using your computer algorithm. If it is circular in shape, definitely you will say it is a ball. It is not going to be a bat, or it is going to be a cat. And similarly, if it is going to be a living object, if you say, you can immediately say it is a cat. Or if there is a handle and then some rectangular shape and so on, so you may say it is a bat and so on. So that means even though there are three objects, all three have got some unique features or characteristics. So you need to write an algorithm which can capture these features and then quantify it. And then, that is what I call it as a model. We can classify an object by mapping its features with our classifiers. See, so this is the simple formula I'm going to use. And don't get afraid of this formula. So this formula is going to tell some probability. So you know that the probability means, for example, when you toss a coin, right? You know that the probability of getting a head, even before tossing, you will say is 1/2. Because there are two options. It can be either head or tail. But then after doing the incident, you are going to get either head or tail. So that means what is the probability of occurrence of an event? You will just take this ratio of two numbers. So here, and I use a bar when I say P of C bar X means, where C means to which class it is belonging to. I'll show you an example, you will understand. And X means what features you are looking at, right? So here, cat, bat, and ball are all called category. And the features are, I say, circular shape, rectangular shape, living object. All these are called the features. So if you want to know what is the probability of a feature, probability of a class given the feature, you will be using this formula. It was invented by a person called Naibase. So let me now go into the details. Assuming that I will take a simple example, I will give you 1,000 pieces of fruit, right? Out of which 500 are banana, 300 are orange, and 200 are some other fruit. So now the fruit being a banana or orange or some other fruit, and imagine we know three features of each fruit. So now I see that there are three classes. Banana is one class, orange is another class, and other fruits are another class. So how many of them? 500 bananas in my basket, 300 on orange, and 200 are other. So totally I have 1,000. And then when I take any one of these fruit out of these 500, I look at some feature. So the feature is, am I asking it is long, or is it sweet, or it is yellow in color? So if you say yes, then I count it, and then that numbers are these. And similarly, I take orange, I ask these three questions. So what you see on the the columns, long, sweet, yellow are features, and in the rows what you see are classes. So typically when you have any data, you can map it into this table, and then you count to how many of them. That's what this Naibase is doing. So here I am calculating the fraction. For example, 50% of the fruits are bananas. Out of 1,500 are banana, 30% are orange, 20% are other fruit. Similarly, based on the data that I have got in the table, right, I am telling out of 500 bananas, 400 are long, means 0.8% is the probability, 400 divided by 500. And similarly, 350 are sweet, means probability is 0.7. And 450 are yellow, means 0.9. Similarly, you do it for orange and do it for remaining fruit and so on. So just to do once if you have all the data, you you create this table, right, where your rows are your classes and columns are your features, and then you you know, take these numbers. After that, you calculate this percentage, all these values. Once if you have there, then I am simply going to use this formula. This is a formula which I was telling, you know, the probability of conditional probability of a class over the feature X is given by the conditional probability of feature over the class, and what is the probability of class and what is the probability of you know, features. So it's very simple. All you look at is this formula. First I say that I want to know whether, so you take a new fruit and then you are asking, is it a banana or not? So in that case, I say that what is the probability for a banana? It can have the features. C means banana. X here are, it can be long, sweet, and yellow. Now we see here in the table, you know, this is P of C and the other features are P of X, C of X. So I am sucking. So in that case, in the right hand side, I write the reverse of it. I take what is the probability of a banana being long, probability of banana being sweet, probability of banana being yellow, and multiply what is in the total number of probability of a banana. So all these values I have already calculated here. I'm just substituting and then I get a probability of 0.252. Similarly, I do it for orange and I do it for any other fruit. So what is the machine learning algorithm is doing is, when I have taken 1,000 such samples and then using my images, if I have got all these features, it is saying that whichever has got the highest probability, I can predict that as the fruit. So that means if the fruit that you have chosen happens to be long and also it is sweet and also it is yellow, then we can say that it is a banana, because based on the data that you have got, you got this number. So the beauty here is that when you add, instead of 1,000, if I have got some 10,000 values, so what will happen is, it may so happen that the value that you get here may be also very different. With more and more data, what is going to happen is the accuracy of your prediction is very high. Yes, sorry.
Sir, again, the voice is less.
Yeah, sorry. Is it audible now? Yeah. So now we can imagine that the scenario which I am going to tell you is that if you are a doctor, what happens is, you know that in the case of a medical application for a given disease, we may have many symptoms. You take one particular disease, like, you know, a viral fever, you may have a number of symptoms, maybe a sore throat or coughing or body temperature. So all those are, you know, features. So you take various medicine, I mean, say various diseases, and then for a given disease, and then you take another disease, it may be like, you know, vomiting. So what are the symptoms or features you will look at in the case of, you know, like a vomiting? So on one side, you have various diseases, on the other side, you have got various, you know, symptoms are there. So now what happens is, for every patient, right, you might have diagnosed after going through it, and he has reported all these things. These are the features. You may be asking, are you feeling, vomiting, or you may asking, are you feeling cough, and so on. So you are going to ask this data. So those are the features. And then you may be arriving at, as a human being, that it is maybe a viral fever. But it may so happen that it is not that the same data, when I give it to two different doctors, you know, they give you a different interpretation. So it may so happen that if you take a large number of patients and then give it to all these, you know, features, and then ask the doctor, how do you predict what kind of, you know, disease he is? So it is going to vary person to person. So when you do a lot of such analysis, you are going to get a table like this. So once if you got the table, then you can do a simple, you know, like ratio calculation. You will be arriving at this kind of, you know, the naive Bayes formula. So once if it is, then, you know, what happens is, now imagine that when you are not there, and I have a huge database which has been created by interacting with a large number of patients with respect to a large number of, you know, doctors. So I take you 100 prescription and then say, these are the symptoms. So how do you diagnose, doctor, or what disease you predict? I note it down. Similarly, I go to the other doctor and then I calculate all these things. So then, you know, what happens is, imagine that once if this algorithm is built and then a new patient is coming and no doctor is there, only a nurse or somebody is there, and then he is telling, so these are my, you know, symptoms. Can you predict what kind of, you know, diseases? So immediately saying, using the about technique, what kind of disease you are suffering from, and so on. So this is something like, you know, the simple text-based data that you take using machine learning, we can bring in, you know, intelligence. As I mentioned, when you have more varieties, you use more features, or you know, when you discuss with more doctors, the accuracy of your prediction is going to be improving day by day. We cannot say it is 100% correct. Just like as I mentioned, the same you know, report, when I give it to multiple doctors, each is, you know, predicting in a different way, slightly different way. Okay, and maybe, you know, for want of time, I may just you know, rush through a few more things. So what we have also done is there are few applications which are based on audio, right? So one of the application is we worked with a leading diabetic hospital in Chennai, and this doctor was telling he used to go to a lot of, you know, schools, especially in Chennai, which are, you know, like private schools, where he found that even in the 7th or 8th standard level, the students have got a lot of, you know, obesity. And then, you know, he want to do their, you know, eye testing. And then, you know, he want to, because we know that one of the implications of obesity or subsequent diabetes is it is also going to affect your eyes. So they wanted to do an eye testing. So typically, you know, we will keep a Snellen chart and ask a patient to stay at 15 feet distance and ask them to read line by line from top to bottom and so on. But then this doctor was telling that when we went there, and we know that, you know, this fellow had a vision problem when even the teachers and parents were complaining. But then when we did the testing, there was no such, you know, implication. Of late, you know, they came to realize that what happened is, the children, we know, they are all always, you know, when somebody is asking, we parents are always telling that if you say, I don't know, or I'm not able to read something, we will feel that as if, you know, offended. That's how we know we are training them. So what these kids were doing is, when the first kid is going, we know that this Snellen chart is a fixed one. In every, you know, like eye doctor or ophthalmology, we see that the same chart is being used. So when a student is coming, first student, he will mug up the sequence of the words like F, B, C, R, N, O, N, B, R, X, and so on. He will tell to the next friend. So the second student, when he comes, without even knowing, because all these are fixed Snellen chart, he will also repeat the same thing. As a result, they were not able to diagnose whether he has really got some, you know, vision problem or not. So he came to us and then said, sir, can we solve this problem? I said, I can use some voice recognition system along with, you know, text processing, I can do it. So what we typically did was, we created this channel chart, which is a static one in a conventional, you know, ophthalmology testing. We made it as a randomized text. So what you see here, for the first student, it may be F. Maybe for the second student, it may be Z. And then third student, it may be O, and so on. So for every student, what we did was, we randomized this text. So when a student knows that what is being displayed on the Snellen chart is different for each, they were not, you know, mugging up and then telling the same thing. And then whenever he was reading, you know, every row, we made an audio recording. And then with the chart that has been, you know, we know that this is the chart, right? You know, where F is there. So I made a translation of text to speech. And then whatever the student was speaking, I did an audio pattern matching. Based on that, I was able to tell whether the first character, what was randomized and displayed, and what is the student has, you know, pronounced, whether they are matching it or not, and so on. So this way, you know, we were able to solve this, you know, problem. So the same thing also we did, and here it was meant for, you know, color blindness. So when a student has got some color blindness, you know, we use these palettes, and then we ask them to read what is the character inside. So again, you know, we know what is the character inside, and then we converted into a speech and then asked the student to read what is the character inside this palette. And when there was a matching, we were able to know that he doesn't have a color blindness. But when then he was reading in a different font or a different alphabet, we know that he has got a color blindness. So we can do a simple automated color blindness testing. And also the kids were very happy because we put some chart in front and asked them, give a headphone, and then there is a mic, and then in a computer we were recording, and then some you know, audio message for them to do, you know, like a fun they were playing, and then they enjoyed it and so on. So we found that this testing was, you know, very effective than we conventionally do with a set of you know, people going and then displaying a standard chart and so on. So maybe in the next few minutes I will talk on deep learning. Deep learning is a subset of machine learning, which on the other hand is also a subset of artificial intelligence. So what is the difference between deep learning and machine learning? Typically in the case of machine learning, what happens is a set of algorithms are trained to make the data. What we do is, the example which I have given, right? So when there is a medical report or diagnosis is there, right? Symptoms are there. And then the doctor was able to tell what disease and so on. So that means some human being has to decode. So this is cough, temperature high, maybe, coughing less, or, all these symptoms are to be manually, the text data need to be, understood. And then the feature need to be, extracted. But in the case of deep learning, what we do is we use something called a neural network. So which is basically a set of neurons, which in your brain is, getting connected and trying to remember things and make decisions and so on. So we mimic these, and in computer algorithm call it as, neural network. So we use a huge number of, neural network in different layers. And then we give a lot of example. And then we ask the neural network, I will do nothing. I will keep quiet. You learn everything by yourself. So the main difference in the machine learning is in the initial stage, a human, is involved in, identifying the features, or what we call feature extraction. Okay. The machine learning algorithms are called flat algorithms because the algorithm cannot normally be applied directly on the raw data. So if you take some, X-ray image and simply give it to a machine learning algorithm, it can't do anything. So what we need to do is we need to do a pre-processing, which is we call as extract the feature, where to focus and what kind of features to look at, how much I need to look at. All these we need to, do it manually. But then in the case of, deep learning, what we do is even that is done by automatic means. So I give simply the data and then the system will learn everything on its own. So this is, in a nutshell, the major difference. For example, I give me an image of a car, and then a human being is sitting. How do I know whether it is a car? I need to tell that it has got two wheels, it has got a steering, or it has got a headlight. All those are, I am classifying it and then feeding this data, and then I am training it. Not only with one car, I will give hundreds of car and then say, this is how the headlight, or this is the place where headlight is there, and so on. And then, finally I will say whether when a given image is a car or not car. So this human intervention is there in the machine learning. But in the case of a deep learning, what happens is there is no human intervention. So everything is, automated, right? And then the output is, obtained. Okay. Maybe I will, explain, something which we have done. And so what we have done is something we have built using artificial intelligence called a medicine identification system. So in many hospitals or nursing homes, we know that there is a pharmacy and the patients are generally buying the medicine which is prescribed by the doctor, especially in private hospitals. But occasionally the pharmacists are making mistake in decoding the prescription. So maybe, he will read only a few things, or if he is not an expert, sometimes he misunderstands it. So sometimes they give you a wrong medicine, wrong type of medicine. As I shown, doctor might have given drop, but he may be giving a suspension or vice versa. And at times they deliver wrong dosage also. He might have given 500 milligram, but he may be giving 650 as well. And sometime he may also give an alternative medicine. So many a time we will, if you are educated, we will take it to the doctor and then say, sir, in the pharmacy, this is not there. He is saying it is inequivalent. Can I take it or not? So without the approval of a doctor, we don't want to take it. So all this calls for the time for the patient as well as for the doctor who is doing, instead of that, this simple work, he can spend his valuable time on meeting more patients. So what we have built is an AI-based system which can validate the medicine given by the pharmacist with the prescription and alert the patient if there are changes and play the medication instruction in the vernacular voice of the doctor. So typically what we have built is we have built a device. So in this particular device, what we need to do is, you put this prescription. So here I see that, this is the prescription designed by the doctor. And this device has got some lighting systems and cameras. And what it will do is, the moment you put the prescription in, it is like, you can imagine like your printer. Just you feed the prescription seat. So this device will switch on the camera and then the lights, and then it will read what is there, right? And then it will know that Rhinocolor drops. So he knows that the name of the medicine is Rhinocolor, the type is, you know, drops. So then it can also read other things, like, you know, he has written hours once, right? Or mani neram oru mani, something he has written in this language. I can even train all these things. It can capture whatever the doctor has written in multiple languages, and then it can store it as a text format or understand as a standard text format. After that, what it has to do is, it has to, you know, it has got a, you know, chamber. You can open the chamber, and then you can put the drops, maybe, you know, the medicine, whatever medicine he has given. So if it is a bottle, right, you know that the name of the medicine should face the camera. But then, you know, we have made a system in such a way that even if you remove the label, or if the label is partially occluded, not visible, even the camera is able to see a part of it, it can clearly tell the medicine that you have put in the chamber is a Rhinocolor, and also it is of drop type. So when these two are, you know, matching, immediately you may get a green light. So I will know that whatever the doctor has written by hand is what is given by the pharmacist. So there is no error in it. Suppose if it is showing an yellow color, I will know that the doctor has given something, but the pharmacy is saying that this is also equivalent. So, but then instead of going into the doctor, if the doctor has already said the equivalence database, so then when it is green, it may play a message in the name of a doctor's voice that the medicine that you have been given is also equivalent to what you are supposed to take. Suppose if we get a red color, then we know that the pharmacy fellow has given a wrong medicine. So it can even identify syrup or drop or suspension. We have done for about 150 pediatric medicine, which was there in their hospital. For all 150 cases, the accuracy was more than, you know, 99%. I can't say it is 100%, but it is more than, you know, 99%. And then comes, you know, even tablet. So the problem with the tablet is that most of the time, you know, what happens is you may give, you know, take Calpol, you know, whenever there is a fever. So instead of buying, you know, 10, I will go to the pharmacy and then I say I want only three tablets. Especially if the tablet is, you know, expensive. In India, they don't dispense only with the strip. They give even cut pieces. So when I take a particular, you know, if it is a full strip, I know that what is the name, expiry, and so on. But if it is going to be only one cut piece, and then, you know, after the next time when I take, I may not know what is the name of the tablet. So normally we remember what is the color of it and so on, if we take it immediately. But after a week or 10 days, again, if a fever comes, if the doctor says you can take whatever medicine I have given last time, so then you want to know what medicine was, how, what was the color and so on. We cannot recollect it. But then the built system, you know, again, you can keep the tablet inside and then switch on the lights and camera, and then it is going to tell what is the name of the tablet. Again, not only that, if the doctor has prescribed how frequently we need to take, what kind of, you know, precautions you need to take, and when you need to take, whichever language he has given, we have also recorded it and played it. And so it is a kind of, you know, a system where whatever medicine which has been written by the doctor is what is dispensed to the patient. And then the patient also, when he is collecting the medicine, he is hearing the instruction for using the medicine once again in the voice of a doctor. The other is, the face recognition system. And of course, we have also done some work in the face recognition system. And here, especially when you want to monitor the people, right, who is there inside, whether only doctor or nurses or somebody else is there. So I want to, you know, use the ICU, you know, I can use it. And we can also, again, you know, use it for eye tracking. Again, there are a lot of, you know, medical applications. We are currently working on tracking our eyes. Using this tracking of eyes from a mere video, I can also diagnose, you know, a lot of diseases. And then, you know, we can also use emotion detection. So using a simple camera, we can detect what is, there are 7 standard emotions which can be easily, you know, diagnosed. So a lot of, you know, psychiatrist doctors, they are in need of, you know, diagnosing this patient. Thanks to COVID, now we want to take only a remote video. From there, I want to diagnose what kind of, you know, like a depression or stress level the patient is and so on, right? So I may stop here, maybe want of time. If there are questions, I would like to take up. Hello.
Yeah, sure, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you for sir. Okay. But also, it was like a very from the basic level you explained us like what are the kind of data available, like text data, images, and also like only after learning how natural language processing is happening, we really understand that how human minds actually process all these things. Because when a doctor writes a prescription, actually no one understands, even the patients from everyone, no one understands what is written in the prescription, but the pharmacist will exactly identify what he has written. So this is the exact difficulty that is happening with the natural language processing, image, and all those techniques. And also you have explained various techniques like parsing, stemming, text segmentation, and all those things.
Okay.
Also, sir, I understood a lot of things. So, is artificial intelligence medicine, is it really necessary? Like, if so, why?
Yeah, it's a very good question. The number one is, there are emergency situation. For example, if there is an accident and then, somebody is, bleeding. And then if you take, some images or scanning. And then if you are asking for an expert, if the expert is not available, especially we've come to know that there are a lot of radiologists in Bangalore. They have started this, decoding the image data and then, predicting what kind of immediate, what we call treatment should be given. So especially people in abroad, they work only 8 hours. So when they don't have an expertise, so the nurses are, clueless, what to do and so on. So many a time it is going to be even, life-saving. So it's of course, I think that, the time has to tell whether it is necessary or not.
Yes, sir, I do recall that during my internship period in the emergency medicine department, when people come, we have to differentiate between hemorrhagic stroke and ischemic stroke. All of the emergency medicine people who are working in the department, they are always well-trained. But still, after immediately taking the CT, we go to the radiologist, we confirm our diagnosis, and then we start the treatment. Because with the alternate diagnosis, the treatment completely differs, and it is completely fatal to the life of the patient if we give the other kind of treatment. So even though we are sure, we are always always looking at the opinion of the radiologist at those circumstances. So since we are working in a tertiary care hospital, the radiologist is available 24/7. But in some other hospitals where the radiologist works for only 8 hours, and if a patient comes in the emergency medicine department and we have to look for whether there is any fracture in the cervical spine to decide on the further treatment, we can't be sending them all those photos in WhatsApp and then asking them. So all those things will be difficult. So yeah, definitely I agree with that, sir.
Okay.
So what is the status of artificial intelligence in medicine? Like, where all, what are the hospitals it is in practice? Like, what are the steps it has reached so far? And how long it will take to come into real existence in almost all the places in medicine?
Sir, again, the
current
status of now,
in medicine,
as of now, as I told you, even for about 150 medicine, I can tell you the difficult challenge is, because even if you take identifying a medicine and then say whether it is a right medicine or not, time and again, even the pharmacy wala is also changing the label, right? Or maybe the shape of the bottle or even the color of the bottle for branding and so on. So once again, you have to acquire the data and then you need to train. It may be even a small change in the font or maybe shape or size or color. So we need to do lot of training again. We have to acquire the images with a different lighting condition from different angle, and then you need to tell it is the same medicine which was given before and so on. So typically the biggest problem we are going to face is the training of a data. Huge amount of data need to be trained, and then whenever there is even a small change, maybe a doctor or a human being can immediately recognize it. As you rightly said, a computer cannot do it, so it has to be trained. But the way the computing that is available, I think things are going to improve, especially people are now talking of, robotic surgery, wherein, just like when laser, etc. came in the beginning, it was not taking up in a big way. But the way the cost of the hardware is becoming cheaper nowadays, I think in another 5 to 10 years and so on, in many of these our Indian hospitals also, we can see the AI based system. But then it may come, you know, one by one, as you were rightly telling, depending on the context or need, where there is shortage of people, it may come in. Yes.
Sir, I do recall one of the even during my internship orientation program where they were teaching us about how to write a prescription, because we have a certain format of how to write a prescription. All the prescription letters should be written in letters. They also quoted one example that a patient, a small 1-year-old child, has from Kolkata all the way from Kolkata to Velur to get the treatment, and intern who has written the prescription, he has given some drug that is like some drug which is acting in the gastrointestinal system. Okay. But because his handwriting is illegible, the pharmacist has given some other drug. Since the patient is also from Kolkata, he has reviewed only after 3 months, and ultimately it turned out to be an anti-cancer drug, and the child came after 3 months with all the hair has fallen, he has hair loss, and the child has become emaciated, and he has ulcers all over the body. So all these complications happened. So even with the humans, all these errors are happening. When the natural language processing is not done in the right way, so maximum errors are possible. And also, as you said, the lot of data we need to analyze all these things, a lot of data we have to feed into the computer. So currently, are there any hospitals using all these technologies, sir? So far I have known, like you quoted one example, like instead of we can use chatbots to see whether the drug is available in the pharmacy or not. In CMC we used to give e-prescription.
Okay.
Drug itself, we know, like there are like about like 4 or 5 pharmacies within the campus itself, and we will know in which campus the stock is available, or else
okay.
It is not available in any other pharmacies, or things we already know. So any other hospital similar kind of setup for
actually
even more advanced things, like
as we are very close to
radiological
we have been working with wellness group, and in fact I have few slides with Dr. George. We have been working, and there, you know, this is the ongoing work which we are doing, it where we want to use for wellness. As you rightly said, you know, we don't want to use AI for making decisions, but we want to use it as a kind of a recommendation system. So even if a doctor, he is like in a cat in a wall, he is for sure what is that, like, you know, ECG, right? When you see the ECG, if you are a doctor, you know, who is well versed, without even reading it, you will tell what it is. But then sometime you want to read it also, you want to know what it is and so on. So same way, we want to use or introduce this as a kind of a recommendation system. The problem we are facing is, you know, we are not getting the medical data, right? So the biggest problem is because of, you know, like confidentiality and so on. In image data, we can do wonderful things. People are, you know, even in Google is doing, you know, a lot of, you know, AI for diagnosis. But how good these diagnoses? Generally, I'm saying that it may be 80% or 90%, definitely not 100%. So over a period of time with a huge amount of data, it may increase. It is not going to replace a doctor, but it is going to assist a doctor. So I would say it is going to be more of an assistive technology rather than a replacement technology.
When I also say about artificial intelligence, it is going to drastically reduce the work of the doctors. Many of them ask the questions like whether it is going to replace the doctor, but definitely it is no, because even in a pathological study, we have to, for a diagnosis of tuberculosis also, we have to look hundreds of slides before giving the diagnosis. So if a person, for a single diagnosis, we have to look at 100 slide images. Mm-hmm. So if we have to continuously, if a person has to look at 100 slides for 100 patients, it accounts to about like 10,000 views per day. So if a person is continuously looking at such a way, so it is going to cause him a lot of burnout. So in all these things, AI can assist, and it is not definitely going to leave it. And especially in countries like India, where the manpower is very much low, artificial intelligence is going to do a great job. So you have told that there is lack of data, confidential issues, ethical issues and all those things. What is the exact reason why we are not using data, whether it is because of cost efficiency or whether it is because of ethical issues, or doesn't have the awareness of
It's a good question, sir. So typically I went into, I don't want to name of the scan center, and they were afraid, like what you said, if I give all this data and then if he is able to predict what it is, people may not come to me and so on. So I think, you know, unless we work with the doctors and engineers together, we cannot, you know, solve the problem. Of course, the ethical issues are also there. But many a time we say you can mark the data and give it, instead of, you know, telling the name of a patient, you give like XXX, YYY, and so on. So often we are facing the problem of getting a real data. So thanks to the doctor with whom we worked, he is a pediatrician. He gave all the 150 medicine and then, you know, gave all his prescription. He has given around 1,000 prescription, which he has not written. But if I go to many of these doctors, they are very afraid. Why I need to give this prescription to you? What are you going to do? Are you going to do something else also? They were worried. Because once if I digitize this, they were a little worried, you know, what I'm going to do. So I think, you know, the confidence between the doctors and the researchers should also should happen.
It seems that it has become time that doctors should realize that we should advance into all these technologies also. So, okay, sir. So how about the cost effectiveness? How much does it cost? So do we have all those infrastructures?
Yes,
or is it because of the lack of
actually, you know, what happened?
We are lacking in.
Yeah. Because the video I'm not able to play. The hardware which you have built, you know, it is not going to cost you more than 20,000 rupees. So from scratch, from the readily available components we have built, we have identified what kind of light, how big should be, where it should be, what kind of camera, what kind of motor, what kind of, you know, software, everything we did it from scratch and so on. So I don't think the only difficulty we are going to face is that the data which you have collected for your artificial intelligence to extract the features and to run, it is going to take maybe sometime, you know, weeks of time. So we need to have an uninterrupted power supply and so on. I don't think that, you know, it is going to be a future. When we tried with 150 medicine, it took about a month for us, you know, to solve and then exactly find all the medicine. But if I go to a pharmacy or if I come to CMC, you may have 40, 50,000 medicine, unless I have a very big computer where I can feed. If I want the model should be built, let us say in 1 hour, then I may need a huge computing infrastructure. But then if you say no problems are, you can give after 1 month. I can even run it in a reasonably, you know, fast hardware, which is costing few lakhs. Then I can get even the model. So it's absolutely not an issue. But the only thing is, you need to have uninterrupted power supply. The system should be running maybe 24/7 for a week or 10 days and so on. So with
how about the return of hospital investing in all these infrastructures?
No, it's going to be, you know, phenomenal, sir. As I said, when I talk to the pediatrician, he is very busy in Vellore or Chittur bus stand. He is nearby, and he is taking about 200 patients per day. Now imagine if a pharmacy is giving an alternative medicine which is not prescribed. He is once again coming and standing in the queue, and then until the next patient comes, he goes inside. And then the waiting patients are getting irritated. And sometime, you know, I came to know when I was sitting there, many they were not coming to the pharmacy because it is taking more time and so on. So for your information, despite being in VIT and nearby Vellore to CMC, I don't want to come to CMC. I always feel that they make us to run around. I have to wait in a queue and so on. This is the kind of, you know, perception what, you know, the common public has got. So rather they go to maybe, you know, some other hospital. The only reason is, they want less time to be spent in the hospital. I mean, typically you may know that many people are sick of going to the hospital or meeting, you know, in a place where there are a lot of patients or there. It is a psychological effect. So when they want to spend less time and then you want to deliver more service, I think definitely you need to go for this AI. Maybe not immediately, as you said, for writing a medicine automatically and so on. But wherever if you are doing this kind of an automation, it is going to make a lot of, you know, attraction to the hospitals.
Okay, sir, you have told that the AI is very important and we have to immediately shift. But also there are various kinds of hospitals, from primary hospital, secondary hospital to tertiary hospital. So as you said, a pediatrician, he might have only a single room without even pharmacy attached also.
Correct.
In India also, we have very things like, we have scan centers separately, we have pathological labs separately, we have blood test plant separately, we have micro labs separately, so we have all this separately. So it works in a collaborative way. Only in a tertiary care hospital, in a multi-specialty center, we have almost all these things integrated together. So they have the infrastructure, they have money and all those things. So how about the for a individual person, for a secondary care center, for a primary care center, so how they can integrate in their system, and is it really effective, useful, or it can be done only at higher levels like tertiary care hospital? Like artificial intelligence should be brought into all these setups, or how, what is your suggestion, sir?
No, we can bring it in, sir. Only the issue we are going to face in AI is this customization, right? How big or how small, what data need to be integrated and so on. Now, thanks to, you know, the cloud, what happens is the moment you scan any image and then if you run your AI algorithm running in a cloud and then if you bring it back, so through your software, again, you know, we need to stitch them together. So it need not be a big hospital or even small hospital. But then if I give you a solution as a kind of an API or running it in a server or cloud, so I can push my data, then within a few minutes, you may be getting the results out of it. So that you need not always have a dedicated facility. If it is a bigger hospital where more people are going, you can use a dedicated facility. But then if you have a tertiary hospital, we can use the cloud-based, you know, approach.
Sir, for small hospitals, we have to have an integrated system for image processing, for a laboratory test investigation, for signal processing, for text processing, right?
Yeah.
If we don't have all those things,
but nowadays these are all not very expensive, sir. Because if you have maybe nowadays, you know, laptop or with one computer and so on, like, you know, nowadays we even take the picture from WhatsApp and then we send it into the cloud. The cloud can do the analysis and so on. But now the problem is, the way you are communicating in WhatsApp and the way you are communicating in Facebook are very different. So the same problem we are facing. If you can make an integrated, you know, the software and application, which may be running locally in your system, and then also what should be locally processed and what should be processed at remote, it is possible. A bit of, you know, customization is what is required now. You know, taking an images, you know, is of course you have a dedicated, say for example, I cannot use my mobile phone for taking, you know, an x-ray. You definitely need to you know, take an x-ray, but then once if the x-ray is available, I can digitize it and give it to my AI and then tell what kind of predictions it can make and so on. So that part we can come in. We cannot replace the existing devices altogether, but wherever the output of a device comes in the form of an audio signal or maybe an image or a text, I can capture it and send it to a cloud, ask my AI algorithm to predict what it is and recommend few things, which a doctor can subsequently use it.
Sir, as you said, like while we text in WhatsApp also, we text in different ways, but the people on the other end actually understand what we are saying, even if there is a lot of grammatical errors, even if there is language errors and all those things. In a similar way, we need customization for individual people to analyze all this data. Okay, sir, so...
Yeah.
Okay. So we understood that doctors play a significant role in establishing AI in the medical, because even though the technologies understand its significance and they have all the infrastructures and all the knowledge, without the contribution from the, it is never going to become possible, right? So what is the contribution of what they should do for these technological advancements to happen?
No,
so lot of audience are watching our videos.
Yeah, the most important thing is the doctor should also understand these basic terminology, and you know, they have to work with the, you know, the engineers, maybe, you know, a hardware engineer or software engineer, and we need to see, as a researcher, what we are afraid of is these, you know, the words, like, you know, most of them are Latin words and so on, we don't remember them. So for us, you know, if you use in a plain vanilla, you know, simple, you know, text message, we can easily understand. So the synergy between the doctors and the engineers is what is missing. But with more interaction and collaboration, I think it will be solved.
So it seems that we should update ourselves with lot of knowledge. We should read ourselves, and into all these things should be integrated soon in the curriculum. I think so, sir.
No, so, okay, the basic jargons, as a doctor, you are busy in something else. But if you know what is machine learning, what is, you know, deep learning, what is AI, what is NLP, okay, what I can do with this, what I cannot do with this, and then you can identify a right, you know, engineer or a researcher. If you give all the input information and then review them, that is more than enough. That's what we did with this doctor nearby. So he gave all the data and he gave his requirement. And then, you know, we understood. Then we again show a demo and then we explained. He was happy.
Okay, sir. Sure, sir. So now I clearly understood that artificial intelligence is really important for the medical field. So as a medico, if I am interested to learn more about these things, how can I learn about those things? What are the sources? Like, are there any courses available? Are there any like materials available? Are there any books or any organizations? Something like that, sir. If I wish to collaborate, if I wish to further, like how can I integrate my
Sir, actually, this is a very, you know, wide field now. What we are doing is, you know, we are reading, you know, a lot of material from the internet. And then there are, you know, standard journals like, you know, IEEE. We say if you are engineers, there is something called IEEE transactions on medical imaging, etc. are there. We look at some standard journals and what kind of research, what kind of data they are using and so on. On the other side also, we visit, you know, a lot of blogs. What are the new algorithms are happening and where they are applying and so on. And then when people in some other domain, we are trying to use it for medical imaging and then we want to see how it is working and so on.
Yes, sir, so if I'm interested, means how can I learn more about that? How can I get the opportunities?
No, we can do a lot of, you know, even Googling, sir. We can do a lot of, you know, Googling. The textbooks for your information are not many are there. And many of these textbooks are, you know, talking more towards you know, writing code or maybe, you know, even the mathematics which is involved and so on. So the best way is, you know, if you look at, you know, some of the blogs which are run by professionals, then, you know, you will get more information.
Okay, sir, sure, sir. So we have theoretically described about all these processing. So taking an ECG also, we get that automated diagnosis always. Like it comes printed in the paper, but also still we see that and still we get the opinion to confirm it.
Yes.
So what is the level of the image processing? Can we automate the diagnosis? Is it possible or what level it is happening at India level? So what is the stage in the current stage in the world level and all those things? So Google, you have also told Google has come, Amazon has come. Everyone has come, like lot of research studies to predict this earlier is happening. So even before the human eyes can detect, they are trying to predict those.
Correct.
So what is the current status?
Now, actually, you know, in India, we are only at the nascent stage and there is not much, according to me, you know, collaboration between doctors and researchers is happening. But then wherever they are doing it, the accuracy, as I mentioned, typically it depends on the how much of data you have and what varieties of data we have. For example, if you take even the face recognition system, the lighting that you use, your conventional lighting or et cetera, are very accurate to recognize who are you. The accuracy is more if you are a black-skinned person. If you are a brown-skinned person, it is less. If you are a white-skinned person, even the accuracy is very less. So it all depends on, you know, what kind of even the ethnic issues are there. And so you need to actually, you know, you make a lot of, you know, customization. So unless this customization, see, if you take a database some images, which has been captured in the US by the patients in US. For example, they have a lot of, you know, skin defect. But when you take in India, thanks to a lot of sun we have, you don't get that much of, you know, skin defects you have. So they do a lot of research and then they gather a lot of information and then they analyze and then they concentrate on it and so on. But in a country like in India, we need to see that what kind of disease we are, you know, prevailing. There are, malaria and so on, which may be prevalent in India, which is very, very rare to see it in countries like in US and Europe and so on. So we people are taking only those data. I know that a lot of our researchers are taking that data and then we are analyzing it. And then probably whatever model I build it and then I test it in your lab, you are not going to get a good result. So we need to closely work with our Indian data, Indian doctor and Indian researcher. That's where we can improve our accuracy. Currently, people are using the data which is available in abroad, but then they want to try it for an Indian patient where the accuracy is also not good. So if you ask me the accuracy, if you have a good amount of data, accuracy can be around 80%. But when you add more and more data like variety, what Google and so on, they may be getting around something around 90 plus also.
So currently in India, we are using the open data to test our system, whether it is actually possible or not. So only the testing is done, we are actually going to people to see the data, but the day, but we are not getting the data is what you are saying, right?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, you are right. You are right.
Okay, so like for, it will take around like next 20 years for India to.
No, I don't think so. It may take in another 5 years to 10 years. So once if we start, you know, creating our own data set and then, you know, work with that, we may be able to catch up quickly.
Okay, sure, sir. So what are the ethical issues that are involved, sir? Because many people are saying it is not ethical and all these technologies should not come into medical practice, especially is what they are saying.
I don't think
intelligence can come into other things, but they are saying in medicine, it is like unethical.
No, actually, you know, when you take all these COVID, you know, when you take biochemistry, you have the issues. But then, you know, reading an image or a signal or a text and then understanding what it is. And then as long as I say it is only a recommendation system, it is not a decision-making system, I don't think you have an ethical issue. But then when you share the data of a particular patient, that is the only place where we have an ethical issue. Other thing, you know, when you use only, you know, biochemistry based approaches, you have ethical. But then the AI use here, I don't think much of an issue.
Is there also in cloud security and all those things, they are speaking about the, if all those data is stored in a cloud or something else, they are asking about the security, how much the data will be secure.
No, those things are, you know, the part of, you know, computer algorithms are. Nowadays, we have powerful security algorithms are there. So if you have a proper, you know, security analyst, and then if the company promises that, I don't think much issue will be there. When they don't secure your data and store for, you know, for cost cutting, then we may land up into the problem. Otherwise, I think it will not be a problem.
Okay, sir. Really, thank you for answering all our questions very patiently, sir. And that's all our viewers have. These are the questions which our audience had. So
okay, thank you, sir. Thank you.
So all the audience who are watching this video, if you wish to connect with our speaker, his social media link will be provided in the description and you can connect with him. Also, if you have any suggestions regarding the next topics, regarding the webinars and regarding the way in which should be conducted, you can always come, you can always text us. And we will be taking the necessary action. So see you in one another useful video. Until then, it's Aravind signing off. Bye. Thank you, sir. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Bye.